So, I will proceed if you do not have any questions on Renoir, and then because Renoir is where we were just talking about, he was the first to employ non-professional actors. Now, what is the meaning of non-professional actors? People who are unprofessional, behave badly? Exactly, who have never done any formal training in acting, and also who are not much exposed to acting, who haven't acted before. So, employment of non-professional actors, this is another feature which the new Hollywood borrowed extensively from the French New Wave. So, Renoir of course was the pioneer, and then people like Truffaut and Godard took it to another level. Of course, we also know famously the actor who played the lead role in The Bicycle Thieves, the Sitar's Bicycle Thieves, he was also a non-professional actor. Okay. And in William Friedkin's, does he mean anything to you? Good. The Exorcist, he employed a real priest who was a non-professional actor, not the main role, but one of the supporting roles for one of a key role. So, French Nouvelle Vogue, and when we talk about French New Wave, we should also be familiar with the Auteur theory. And Auteur theory you will understand much better if you read Andre Bazin's theories on what is cinema. Okay, so, one of these days when we start discussing the theory part of this course, more when you have to make your presentations, perhaps some of you can opt for a discussion of what is cinema. And directors, as we were talking about when we started this course, the directors were considered as authors and authors. So, let me go back again to one of our earlier classes. What is an author according to the new wave cinema? Who according to you could be an author? Please focus on them.
Director whose films can be read like a text.
Okay. Elaborate. To become an author, what are the things that people should do?
He or she has his own signature style or something which can be seen in all of his work.
Okay. Okay, that comes later. A signature theme, a signature style. Hitchcock had a signature style, right? So, when French New Wave people started developing this particular so called Auteur theory, much debated, much debunked theory. Okay. You do not have to take any theory on its face value, every theory is contested. So, when French theorists started discussing Auteur theory, who did they take in consideration? Not their own people, but Hollywood directors. And who were the Hollywood directors who most influenced them? Please, louder, louder.
Orson Welles.
Okay, Orson Welles is a textbook for everyone. Citizen Kane, a 1940 movie. John Ford, the man who made all those great westerns with John Wayne. Who else? Hitchcock. Hitchcock was an author for the French New Wave theorists and filmmakers. So, Hitchcock was important. And also Howard Hawks. Now, Howard Hawks, some of you may not be aware of Howard Hawks, but he was one of the greatest ever. Can you mention some of his films?
1932.
Yes, Scarface, 1932, Paul Muni starring. Now, Al Pacino's version came much later, but the original Scarface was by Howard Hawks. What else? Since our friend just said that an author should have a signature style. So, what other movies did Howard Hawks made?
Sorry,
Bringing Up Baby with Cary Grant, His Girl Friday again with Cary Grant, Rio Bravo with John Ford. None of these films have the same theme. One is an action movie, the other is a western, and there are several romantic comedies. Still, Howard Hawks was considered an auteur because he had a certain style, and because, so auteurs were not considered auteurs only because they had a certain thematic thread running through their oeuvre. They were also considered important because they had a certain degree of control over their materials. So it was not, it is a very simplistic way of saying that auteurs would always use the same actors, auteurs would always use the same technicians, the music director, the cinematographer, that is there, but that is not the main thing. Auteurs, the most important feature was that the auteurs were supposedly in complete control of their product. And what is the product? Cinema, their film. And what could be better, what could be having better control over their product than writing their own scripts? So that was very important. They wanted complete control over writing their scripts, dialogues, screenplays, although it was normally done in collaboration with someone, because one man cannot do anything but everything by himself. But they would like to have control over the way the film was written. So it was not as if anyone can give them a bound script and then ask them to write to make a movie out of it. It was not done that way. They had complete control over the other aspects of filmmaking. Okay, so that is auteurism. And some of the best known films: 400 Blows by Truffaut, Breathless by Godard, Band Apart again by Godard, and several others. Okay, so the auteur theory was developed by Andre Bazin, a very important film critic, and his disciples. Now, disciples also happen to be film critics, and then they decided that if we criticize so many movies and if we are so unhappy with the way films are made, then why don't we make our own films, our own kind of film, which was like a breath of fresh air for French cinema, which was almost dying at that point. So some important names along with Andre Bazin, Truffaut, Godard, René. René made a classic called Hiroshima, My Love, Mon Amour, and Last Year at Marienba. That is another, when we talk about repetition and narrative in narratives, then we will be discussing Last Year at Marienba. Did I ever discuss that film with you, with your group? Perhaps I did in one of my earlier classes. So René's Last Year at Marienba is an important movie by way of its narrative, telling the same incident over and again, which was later done to perfection in
Vantage Point.
Good, Vantage Point, yes, but there is another classic. Rashomon is, yes, yeah, multiple perspectives, yes, good. So Rashomon, what else did you mention?
Vantage point,
yes. In between there was something, Bill Murray.
Groundhog Day.
Groundhog Day. Okay. So those are the films that you should be, we will be discussing when we talk about narrative and repetitions. So René's Last Year at Marienba. Tell me, any comments here?
Christopher Nolan said parts of Inception were influenced by Last Year at Marienba.
Of course, yeah. It's a very dark, edgy movie, although Nolan's movie is a thriller. Okay. It has action, it has great special effects. Last Year at Marienba is an out and out love story based on a novel, again Nouvelle Roma, the new kind of novel. And Claude Chabrol, Romer, and Louis Malle, so these were the people who ushered in the era of French New Wave. And as we were just talking about The manifesto was, the director was the real author of a film and not the studio. So, it was, in other words, a revolt against the entire studio system, which is something you will find, which something happened in the 60s in Hollywood with Bonnie and Clyde. Bonnie and Clyde and the subsequent next 10 years, they were the so called new Hollywood. Okay. And when you had films like William Friedkin's Exorcist, but Exorcist is more conventional. Before Exorcist, there was the French Connection, which got him the Oscar. Wonderful movie. Okay. So, the author or the the director is the star of the film. That was the idea, not the actors. Therefore, insistence on having non-professional actors. In Hollywood, there was a director made three great movies. I will ask you his name, and he was very insistent. He is also a great film critic, okay, but that is another thing. He made three movies which were all classics, and after that there was a constant downhill, downfall, and he insisted that film, that the director is the real star, the hero of the film. Okay. And he would very consciously take only those people, insist on having only those stars who were by and large very uncharismatic, because he did not want anyone to overshadow his powers. I will give you the titles of this, his films, if I can remember all, most of them, and then you have to give me the name. He made The Last Picture Show, yes, and Sybil Shepherd. Then he made Paper Moon with Ryan O'Neill and his daughter Tatum, and then in between he made What's Up Doc, Barbara Streisand, three super successful and critically acclaimed movies, and then it all went to his head and then there was a constant downfall. Peter Bogdanovich, okay, so director being the star, insisting that the director should be the star. Peter Bogdanovich. Similar thing happened to Paul Schrader also. Paul Schrader, the screenwriter for Good, Taxi Driver, and also the director for well, do your homework. Paul Schrader, what did he do? Okay, what is his contribution? Because again, like Bogdanovich, he could not sustain his success. Again, like William Friedkin, who made The French Connection, got an Oscar, okay, then followed it up with a very successful The Exorcist, okay, but could not follow. I mean, after that, there were nothing. So, pitfalls of the authorism. Okay, when directors start asserting too much control over their product, it is all very good on paper. But there were pitfalls as well, which was very evident, especially in the new Hollywood cinema. They all started with a bang. Okay, this was the Journal of Films Cahier du Cinéma. I keep talking about this, but just to repeat, just to refresh, launched in the 1950s, and it was a journal of French films, very respectable journal. The policy was put into practice by the filmmakers of the French New Wave of the 60s. The idea was to go against the studio system and big budget films. The idea was not to rely on big stars, and the idea was not to follow the genre conventions. We know what are genres? Do we know what are genres?
Categories.
So, that is a very simple definition of genre. So, Scarface is a gangster genre, okay. But genres are also much debated, contested categories, okay, because now we talk about genre blending and genre bending. So, if you want to read a very scholarly book on genres, you must read a work called Film Genre. It's by Rick Altman. Rick Altman's Film Genre. And one characteristic feature of the Auteur theory was that the style becomes independent of the story. The style was extremely important. Remember Bonnie and Clyde, you must watch Bonnie and Clyde and then understand how important style was. After all, it's just a gangster film, okay, and it combines features of love story as well, but then it was the style of the movie in which it was shot that became important. So when Ranjit tells you our Auteur theory is based on a signature style, actually is the way you shoot the movie, the way you present a movie. Some directors were known for shooting the film in natural lights, okay. For example, if you watch a movie like Macabre and Mrs. Miller, Warren Beatty's film, which was shot out and out in Vancouver and directed by Robert Altman, and Robert Altman insisted those days in the early 70s that he is not going to do any dubbing for the film. Everything has to be in sync. Now, what happens when you are, when everything is in sync and when you are shooting in cold, extremely cold climes of Vancouver in Canada, wind blowing throughout, what happens to the sound?
Muffled sound.
Muffled sound, okay. And even today, even with the restored version, Macabre and Mrs. Miller has a very odd sound to it. They all liked it when they first made it because they thought that they are auteurs, you see, complete control of the way, this is the way we want the movie, okay. But the audiences were so put off, no one ever bothered to watch the movie, although it is now considered a classic. It is a cult movie, it has recovered its cause because it was so appreciated for its style, but then it did not make any money for the producers, okay. So, Auteur theory and its pitfalls, okay. So, coming back to what Kaiyer du Cinema told us. For an Auteur film, there is no pre-existing story. The writer, the director has complete control over the material, and they believed in improvisation, okay. So, if the director is not happy with the way sun is setting or the moon is rising, they would not shoot the scene, okay. And they would just keep on improvising it till they get that so called perfect shot. And the bottom line was that director is more important than anyone else on the sets, including the stars, including the producer, okay. So, just to encapsulate, Auteur's theory rejected the cinematic practices of the 1950s. They believed in making low budget films. They shot on locations with new or non-professional actors, challenged the studio system, and of course preferred natural light to studio light lighting, and preferred natural sound to extensive studio dubbing. So, that is the takeaway from today's class. We will continue tomorrow. Thank you very much.